personally pleased that Matthias is here because Matthias is a very special guy. He long ago forgot how to be boring, which is amazing coming from Stuttgart, right, where you should have lots of training in how to be boring. He's simply not, and there are many different ways to describe the work. I think what's great about the work is it's really no description is very adequate to the mission. The mission is not just a technical one. It's not just some of the most beautiful conceptual work and technical work elevating the way that architecture can behave. But more importantly, I think Matthias is never understood as the person who comes afterwards. He's many times, in a way, the one that's slightly before. So in a certain way, architects become his students. So he's a teacher not only at the GSD, but he's also a teacher of architects. And I think the architects that work with Matthias, and they are pretty much the architects you love. I mean, because if you're a really good architect, one of the signs that you're a good architect is that you work with this guy. So those of you who are in the room that don't work with this guy, you get the point. And all of them, in a way, afterwards think that they learned a lot. And I also know from spending time with Matthias that he's very proud of the architects that now, even without him, have absorbed a kind of different philosophy. So I think it's something like as a philosopher of energy that Matthias is really the right name, and why we like him so much, why I like him so much, and why he's just absolutely the right person to. Having said that, he never comes after, that he comes after here today at the end, Matthias.
Yeah, from family, thanks Mark for the introduction. From family role, I'm the last of six children, so I came and the last of the third pair of twins. So in a certain way that I'm used to be the last, but you can be the first. Okay, so in a certain way, thanks for the invitation, and I certainly decided not to do it by video, but to come on my own, not be so important. And I think when I was just rethinking on the title of the, and I think we already saw this today, other people had done the same, it's, my thinking is clear, it's not about the future of energy, it's the future of us, because we know, and, oh, I have to take this, that in a certain way, energy will be always there. Let me see which direction we're going. Okay, that's high sophisticated. Back next. Okay. So normally you would see now the first law of thermodynamics. Ah, here we go. You have seen this already before. Engineers love this because it's clear. Something we have to explain, energy cannot be lost. It's always there. You're just changing the level of energy. So that's why I said, if this, and we have to be in a certain way, and I love the introduction from our friend from NASA. Sorry. Forgot your name. In a certain way, we're in a certain way zooming in from the universe. We have to definitely aware, we as human beings, that we are just a little pups in this universe. And if we are messing up this planet, the system will go on. It will just, there will be no change on the system. So we are messing up our planet. And when I saw the pictures this morning from New Orleans, it's kind of, we are so stupid, kind of messing up such a beautiful planet. Okay, so, and energy flows, and so energy will be always there, and our sun will run for the next millions of years producing a lot of energy, and if we harvest it or not, it will just spread it. So the universe, in a certain way, is the most energy-wasting system, but there is a lot of it there. So in a certain way, and we are kind of dealing with a bit of it, which is accumulated, what we as well heard, over millions of years being stored in fossil fuels. So in a certain way, it runs from a higher level to a lower level, and if we want to increase it, we have to put energy in. So that's the kind of the thermodynamic background, the physical background. Now, this is the development that's now the energy consumption development of the United States between 1775 and 2010. And you see whatever we have, the wood age, the coal age, and then the oil age, and hopefully we are now talking about the solar age. But my sentence down there, we're spending more and more energy, do we get more happy? Now, thinking back in one or two generations, already my grandma had a quite small footprint, much more smaller than me, mine. Now, the question is, where these people, and we heard this morning from Jeffrey Sachs, if he goes to countries where it's only based on biomass as a driving force, in a certain way, the living is quite simple. The question doesn't mean that we have to go back to this kind of simple living, but the question is, what is the standard of living we think we demand? And it's directly connected, in a certain way, to our kind of consumption of energy, and this is kind of the GDP per capita and the power consumption, where you can easily see Canada, but as well the European countries being up there with a high income, but as well a high energy consumption, and down there going to the majority world, which in a certain way this is where most of the people live till now. They are living on a low GDP and a low energy consumption. And that's in a certain way as well. Our wealth is as well based on the energy we are spending. And in a certain way, we are spending now for cheap money. And this country may need for the future to develop to be at the same wealth level as we are. So comparing, this is now the world map with the energy consumption of the different countries. And if you take this and then go to the next one, which is the ecological footprint, and I go back a picture, in a certain way you can quite see there's quite a good parallel that the guys which spend the highest amount of energy, they have the biggest ecological footprint, typically 3 to 4 times more than the planet would be able to take if all of us would consume this amount of energy, material, so on. So in a certain way, and if we relate this to the World Happiness Index, that was the question, we spending more energy, are we getting more happy? Then it's interesting that, for example, if you then can overlay the happiness to the ecological footprint, and the country with the smallest, or in a certain way, with the highest satisfaction, with the lowest ecological footprint, is Costa Rica. So in Costa Rica, people with the lowest kind of material input, having the highest life expectations, the highest kind of happiness index all over. And Scandinavia is as well a part of the evaluation where you get quite high numbers. So I think that's something we have to have in mind as later on, we see it in a minute, when we compare life quality and life standard. And I think I'm not so sure, and I think that's a question we definitely have to raise in the connection with energy, if the life standard we are living today in the so-called developed world, which is the minority world, because we are the minority of the population of the world, if this is a target for the rest of the planet, if yes, then this might be a big problem for, in a certain way, saving this planet. So, and the other question is, how long will we really need to learn that we are facing a problem? And it's kind of amazing, all of you have heard this week, the newest IPCC report came out, which in a certain way raised the kind of the number that we human beings are responsible for climate change from 90 to 95%. So in a certain way, even maybe the last people now should know it. What is very interesting, in 1972, there was the limit of growth by the Club of Rome. This was published. I read it during my student time, and we discussed it a lot in our commune, if we should go on like this, or we have to, in a certain way, it would not be responsible to have kids, for example. So. And then you see the first IPCC report, 1919, Kyoto Protocol. It looks like we're just going on. This is, by the way, that's the country which signed it, which partially signed it and like the US and rejected it afterwards, stepped out of it. So in a certain way, I think it looks like there is no understanding that this is just such a pressing problem. And I think the big point is we will understand it if we get like a Sandy hurricane into New York three times every year. But then it will be too late, because then the system is already above the tip. And I think that's a bit the point where I think we as academic people, we have to create, we are, and our politicians as well, a lot of them know this. They understand it, right, in a certain way, but we are missing people who take the responsibility to say, we have to do decisions, and if they are unpopular, we have to do the decisions in a certain way for the next and the next generation. So, and yeah, we heard it. It's not only a problem in respect of our climate, it's as well a problem in respect of our economy. You may have, some of you may have read the report, Why a Four Warmer World Must Be Avoided by the World Bank. So the World Bank commissioned kind of this report, which is by the Potsdam Institute of Climate Change. The main point from the executive summary: the consequences for human security, economics, and trade systems. Because this big changes above 4 degrees, and we already heard this morning it maybe even go up to 6. This will kind of create such an enormous kind of pressure on humankind. I think what this planet hadn't seen before. So I think that's something, it looks like all the information is there, the information gets every year underlined, but we behave as this would be something which may happen in 100 years, but it may happen quite soon. And we heard this morning that maybe nuclear power might be a solution. This is just the results and the consequences out of the Fukushima kind of catastrophe, where in a certain way you see a big zone, 150,000 people had to be evacuated. They probably have to be permanently out of this zone. They will not be able to go back to their houses. The ranges are between 250 and 500 billion US dollars as a damage. So I think such a system is too risky to rely, even if it would not produce carbon dioxide, but it would create a lot of nuclear waste, which we have to handle in the next 100,000 of years. So I think that's not a path to go. An interesting approach, and some of you may have followed the news last week, when the president of Ecuador, he made this proposal that one of the last remain rainforests, this kind of, it's called Yasuni National Park, this kind of U-shaped part of the park, where they discovered a lot of oil below the rainforest, which is the rainforest with the highest biological diversity on this planet. And he made a proposal to the world, if the world would pay $3.6 billion to his country, he would leave this last remaining rainforest untouched. This proposal was done 3 years ago, and like a week ago, they closed it because they had only collected $13 million since that time. So they decided now to go for drilling oil in this last remaining. And I think that should raise the question, what is the price of such a last unique resort on our planet? We saw these pictures this morning from the Mississippi Delta, which is gone, but this is a piece which is still there. And just to, in a certain way, following Forrest's kind of definition, just to heat with kind of low energy, low exergy output, our houses, to destroy such a unique place on our planet, I think that's not the right decision. So it's interesting if you compare, and this is, and I expected Forrest would talk about it because he is quite familiar with this one. The Swiss people, we all know that they are trading with a lot of the money of the world in their little country. They started to do a kind of research, okay, what does it mean in energy consumption and carbon production if we take the value of the world at a minimum today? And where is the world as a mean value? Where is Switzerland, the whole Europe, where is the US And this is down here what I call the maturity world. This is the maturity world, and if they will be by people at where we are, in a certain way, this is, and this is by person, in a certain way, then in a certain way, the balance would not be happening. So in a certain way, they defined, if everybody would go down to this 2,000 watt, in a certain way, 2,000 watt in the definition of their researchers was a permanent power of 2,000 watt day and night, the whole year around, which has to cover your daily life, including your travel, including the gray energy for material and construction you are using. So that's kind of a more holistic approach, not just looking on one building, but on your whole footprint. What is interesting, they are calling this approach the 2,000 watt society. So it's not about a 2,000 watt building, it's about a society. Because this problem we can only solve as a society, not as an individual. We may solve it in our little house, but this will not have an impact. So in a certain way, this is where they found out where they are today. So they have, and Switzerland luckily has a lot of hydropower, around 30% of their kind of energies by non-fossil fuel. It's mostly hydropower, and then the rest is on fossil fuels. So they said, until 2150, we want to be down at 2,000 watts, which means, and then three-fourths out of it, 1,500 would be out of renewable, and only around 500 watts would be out of fossil, because this 500 watts correlate directly to around 1 ton per person. The balance of our planet shows this planet can roughly take 8 billion tons carbon dioxide every year being digested in the system without a big change in the system. We are at the moment 7.2 billion people, so if we're expecting there's a certain growth, if we spread it, everybody can spend 1 billion. So that's the kind of the mathematics behind this approach to say, okay, we say 2,000, we can cover 1,500 by renewables, but then the last 500, that's the 1 ton we allow everybody to spend. What is interesting, in 2007 and 2008, whole Switzerland voted for this with a majority of the people, and Switzerland is one of these basic democratic countries. So the majority of the Swiss people, by a public vote, 1-to-1, voted that this is for 2150 the target for the whole Switzerland. And then Zurich voted afterwards, and they voted that it's already in 2050, which is quite close, already the target for the city of Zurich. What is interesting, they're already kind of introducing new legislation in Zurich, for example. If you do a new development for an apartment building, you don't have to build parking if you sell with your apartment the annual ticket for the public transportation system. So in a certain way, it has to follow up with some regulations on it, and I think it's actually a big discussion, and there are even people talking about we should do even a 1,000 watt society on this kind of how we reach this target. Now, it's clear, and that was the big question, how we read this without losing comfort. And then I think that's interesting, we have to distinguish between life quality and life standard, which means in a certain way life quality in respect of happiness, satisfaction, and well-being, while life standard is a collection of material and material luxury. And in respect of life standard, for example, as well fits how many square meters we need for living. Because if you take the numbers, the development in Europe, and I know it better on Paris, in the 1960s, they were down to 25 square meters per person living in the city. Today, they are at 45 square meters. Until 2030, they're expecting 65 square meters. So we are increasing, in a certain way, the ground we are living on, which means we live on our own in our lonely apartments with our refrigerator, which we only have to fill up once a week, and the cities are dead. So in a certain way, saying kind of as a pressure in life standard, and you can see it in like in Tokyo, living in a city where the pressure is much higher, people live on a smaller footprint, would push the people out. And we heard this morning from California that people there are spending much more time outside than inside. It might be a bit more problematic in Paris, where it gets a bit chilly in winter. But in a certain way, this kind of life standard, where we heating, cooling, lightening, ventilating 65 square meters per person, in a certain way, reducing this to a certain number would relieve, in a certain way, a lot of the energy we are consuming. And it's interesting, there is one of the big developers in China at the moment, Vanke, which does like 150,000 apartments a year. They are developing at the moment, they find out that the new Chinese, the young Chinese couples, which typically buy their apartments, certainly both working, cannot afford the typically 85 square meter apartment, which normally holds the couple at the beginning, then they get one or two kids, then the grandparents move in because they have to raise the kids because they're both working. So this apartment has to take up to six people. They find out they are too expensive. So if they would be able to reduce it to 65 square meters by increasing the quality of the outdoor spaces around the building, this is relieving the financial pressure on the apartments. So this is a pure economical decision in this way, is to go this path. Now, and in this life standard, that's just a picture I stole from the 2000 Watt Society webpage. In a certain way, comparing what kind of standards we want to live, what kind of food we want to eat, how we want to move from one place to the next. Do we really need to go on vacation? It's quite cheap nowadays to fly to Turkey or to Egypt or wherever. Is this really necessary to keep our happiness on the related index? So in a certain way, and that's something we hear, and that's as well interesting, comparing now European and North American kind of culture. There are different ways to reach this efficiency. Okay, increasing, you have a better machine, a better heater, which does the same output with less input. Consistency, you're trying to do the same consumption but replace like the fossil fuel by biofuel, which in a certain way would need so much biofuel, and we heard the number in a certain way covering big surfaces. Or sufficiency, meaning kind of less is more. And I think that's a kind of an approach which as well comes back to our individual decision, because sufficiency means less material, a slower speed of living, in a certain way, maybe disconnecting yourself from this kind of global approach, more or less, more region, more identity, less commercializing of your life. So in a certain way, I think that's a quite interesting kind of point they hit as well in this approach, that it's not only we mainly discuss nowadays on efficiency and consistency, but that we have to rethink, especially in the minority world, we have to rethink the standard of our living. What we already saw this morning, this is our great energy source in our system, whatever. I did it in megawatts, not in terawatts. So a trillion megawatts, the energy, a little part of it just reaches our planet, but compared, this is 10,000 times less than we get on the planet. So in a certain way, there is a big source. It's quite democratically distributed over the whole planet. So in a certain way, that's the perfect source, to feed a system. Some of you may have heard of this European approach, which at the moment is a bit struggling, that they want to connect whole Europe to North Africa in a kind of an energy grid system where wind power with solar power, with tidal power, with biomass is combined in a big energy loop. What is interesting in this, if you zoom in, this is now the numbers for 2005, but 2010 or 15 wouldn't be much bigger. This is the surface in the Sahara, assuming a 10% efficiency solar concentrating plant, you would need to feed the world with electricity. That's a joke. In a certain way, it's quite big, but in relation to what we saw, what all our energy kind of demand is destroying on this planet, this area looks quite small. Now, we just heard in respect of different kind of levels. We have to define energy in respect of consumption, what we spend in our houses to run our houses, but there's as well a big package we bring in when we build houses. And in a certain way, if and there were just a discussion on passive houses, so if we start with standard low energy buildings, you have a certain approach you have to put in to build your house. This is the so-called embedded energy in your building materials. And then for a certain time you run it, you have certain kind of refurbishment periods after a certain time when certain components have to be replaced. So this is kind of the lifetime. And then you're probably dismantling it, hopefully not before 60 years, maybe even longer, then in a certain way you spend as well a certain amount of energy. Now in a passive house, typically we have to be aware the slope, which means the consumption, and I made it quite simple without the steps, they would have as well the steps in between. In a certain way, the slope is much lower because you're using, in a certain way, your consumption is less, but in a certain way, the embedded package at the beginning is higher, and you would extend it to a zero-energy house, it would be even go higher, and then the line would be nearly straight. So that's something we have to compare, and we just heard from Forrest in respect of the embedded energy of insulation, having another 10 centimeters, which doesn't do a lot, in a certain way, to the overall system. In a certain way, that's exactly where we have to do holistic performance evaluation over the lifetime of a building, as well thinking about how we get at the end 40 centimeters of insulation, what we do with the material after the lifetime of the building. So it's a kind of an approach we have to look to see in an overall picture. And if we talk about energy, don't forget food. And this is kind of a number calculated for the US. For one calorie on your table, you are investing 7.5 calories in energy. And this is now a minimum value. If you go to special food and kind of comparing veggie to meat, it's the difference is much bigger. And I just said, have a veggie day. Unfortunately, the Green Party in the German elections like 2 weeks ago, they lost a lot because that was one of their last proposals to introduce governmentally a one-day vegetable day. And it looks like the Germans still are too conservative to accept it. 8.5% voted Green, but they had been up to 12, 15% before. So I think that's as well something to have in mind when we talk about energy and our carbon footprints, how we live our life, in a certain way, what we are taking for normal to be able to consume in respect of food as well, a lot of energy is and resources, water, whatever, is embedded to it. We heard a bit this morning on the external costs because often this kind of approaches with renewable energies are rejected because they are so expensive. This is not a totally actual kind of study by the Fraunhofer Gesellschaft in Germany where they compared the conventional electricity generation with the so-called external social costs on whatever, the damage on building, the damage on health of the society, which normally is not paid by the consumer, but by our tax system, and then finally by us, because through the government it's finally paid as well. So the comparison of external cost, in this case comparing wind energy, which in the total comparison in the first moment is different, kind of is shifting the picture. And when I heard this, you said the return of investment of fossil fuel compared to renewable is factor 20 higher. Some of these factors are definitely hidden in this kind of not considering of the external costs. And this is as well a nice study on the German market. Now, if you take all of this external costs, climate change damage, human health impact into account, in a certain comparing nuclear power to photovoltaic, to wind, this is black coal, brown coal, so in a certain way, the shift is different. And then if you see, these are the billions of euro the government put into renewable, but this is the billions they put into nuclear. So there are around 187 billion euro put into nuclear over the last, whatever, 40, 50 years. So certainly that makes the system unbalanced. And even if the people are now outcrying that there is a kind of a support for renewable, I think the systems are just not balanced. So there was a big lobby, and we heard this morning, on this lobby is partially sitting in the wrong committees now, still having the oil hat on their head, supporting or not supporting certain developments. I think that's something we have to have in mind when this lobbies, and I think these lobbies are strongly influencing on our politicians not to do decisions they have to do, they should do today. So, and I think hydrofracking, we heard as well this morning from Jeffrey, I think that's a bad idea. Because in a certain way, you're poisoning your ground and your water. In a certain way, and I think if we think back like 7, maybe still 5 years, there was a strong pressure because everybody was talking about that the fossil fuels are limited. Luckily, they were limited. Now they are not anymore because we're deciding, whatever, to drill in the Antarctic, to drill in the rainforest, to frack our ground, putting poisoned water down into the ground to get the gas out? For what? To run just our cars as we did the last 15, 20 years? So I think that's definitely, and in a certain way, it led to an increasing in energy consumption because energy is so cheap. And I think for the American president, it was a strong support because it made the American economy grow. But in a certain way, for what a price? That would be the question. Maybe the next generation or two generations after us will ask. When in 2010 they invented the fracking. So I think we need innovation, but we need people to do it and not just talk about it. And that would be my comment to Jeffrey Sachs' kind of discussion this morning. I think we don't have to wait for a big new research in technology. The technology is there. We need people who are deciding to go for it. And one example, and some people of you are familiar with this project. This is a project we did with the architectural offices Sana'a in Essen. This is the old coaling mine site of the Zeche Zollverein. They digged for coal like 85 years. They closed it down in 1985, which means they closed the top. They're still pumping from minus 1,000 meter. Permanently the mining water to keep the mine dry. Because of political reasons, they may think to dig for coal maybe in what, how many hundred years, I don't know. So that is a governmental decision because all the mines are governmentally owned. Now, pumping this water out in a certain way is like between 300 and 600 cubic meters an hour. That's a huge amount. They're spending just on this mine, 1 million euro a year, just in electricity for the pumps. What is interesting, if they would stop pumping, it would slowly fill up, but at least at around 400 meters, they would need to start to pump in any way, because the whole Ruhrgebiet dropped down in the last 100 years by 20 meters because of all the mining. The whole site is full of mines. So if they would let the water grow up to the surface, the whole Ruhrgebiet would lift up again 20 meters. And this would be infrastructural for the houses. They had one mine close to Aachen where they stopped the pumping. And they have a little village where there is a break through the village, through the streets, through the houses of already like 4 inches going through anything in 5 years. The kind of the ground moved. So I think that's another nice example of they stopped digging for coal. But now, still 40 years later, and this will be the next 100 years, we have to pump the water out to keep the system not from lifting up again. So in a certain way, we are not only messing up, in this case, the coal is gone, the only the hot water is what is left from this mining. But in a certain way, it shows that what we do it over a certain period still has a certain kind of consequence in the future. So what we did, and that's this building which is quite known, Sana'a Zollverein School, we kind of used this water coming out of the ground with around 30 degrees Celsius, around 95 degrees Fahrenheit, and we pumping it through the walls. And it's similar to Forrest's approach. In this case, we get it for free from the ground. We pump it through a 10-inch uninsulated monolithic concrete wall. And minimalistic architects like Sana'a were very happy to build it like this. And we heat the wall as it would be insulated. Now, in the first stage, that's energy wasting. The point was, we could save 1.5 million in this much simpler wall construction than a double shell concrete wall with an inner insulation would need. And we spent $500,000 to connect, and this is the pipe, connecting it back to the old mining shaft. We spend this $500,000, now the next building, which will come afterwards, have this system ready to go. And it was a big discussion on, in this case, it needed innovation, because the client asked for the reference. There was no reference. I told him, you are the reference. It hasn't been done before. So it took a certain while to convince him that it's not too risky, and we are engineering. We're doing a good engineering. We make sure that there's no failure. And if there's a failure, it's not creating a disaster. And it was interesting because the discussion with that they had to pump again was not in anyone's mind. The only point was when it came out, the client said, if you do the system, what happens if the Ruhrkohle AG stops pumping? And then we said, okay, we can calculate it. Where would get the energy from? And then we talked to the guy and said, no. We pump. You may wait a year. After a year, we have to pump again because then it's at 400 meters and then we have to pump the rest of how long we know. So I think that's quite interesting. Jumping from Germany into Masdar, now, this is purely in a certain way based on energy and carbon emissions, because 2004, Abu Dhabi or the United Arab Emirates were blamed by the WWF to be the worst country in the world with the biggest ecological footprint. Now, in their Islamic culture, the saying of your forefathers is quite important. And the founder of the UAE, Sheikh Zayed, who is the father of the today emir, he led them with one message that they should treat their country as their forefathers did and respect for the next and the next generation. Now, to be blamed to be the worst country in the world, they felt like really blamed. So let's spend $25 billion to build the first carbon-neutral city of the world, taking into account that it doesn't need a payback in 6 to 8 years, but allowing the team to develop a concept that it pays back in 30 years. So that was always, and was even during the whole design, evaluated if this payback by energy saving, by energy replacement, and carbon trading would be enough in a certain way to compensate for roughly, could say, out of the $25 billion, around $7 to $8 billion were the approach between a standard low-energy city to a carbon-neutral city. And what is interesting, if you go to this place, and then we are back to tradition, because it's just that my grandma had a much smaller footprint than I have. She was never in America, by the way. They changed in a period of around 40 years. In 1960, 1970s, Abu Dhabi was a little fish village. Now, they changed from the tent to the high-rise, from the camel to the SUV, from a quite low-diet food to meat. What is the consequence? And I think that's very interesting. 33% of the Emiratis are high diabetes. So this is the second highest diabetes rate of the world. So a society changed its culture in a high speed in 40 years, but their bodies couldn't follow. And I think that's quite interesting that, you know, certainly what we have to have in mind when we're thinking on this kind of changes. We had two or three generations and we adapted. So I think that's in mind. So in respect of energy, the consequence, and I'm not talking explaining Masdar as it all because it would take another hour. So the consequence was to do a zero carbon development on the site, producing energy on site, using the today's standard of UAE, we would cover the whole site with solar systems and we would not even reach half of the demand of the buildings. So it was clear we had to reduce it. This is efficiency. So this is reducing the demand to do the same than you approached before. Maybe make the rooms a little smaller from whatever, a 35 square meter student apartment to a 29 square meter apartment. That was discussions we had during that time. So reducing this and then covering only half of the site, because we said it would be the wrong message to the world that the first carbon neutral city would be living in a solar plant. So they built 50,000 square meters, which is like I would say 25% of the university, which is the breeding, the heart of MASTAR, the MASTAR Institute of Science and Technology. 50,000 square meters are built. They are in operation since October 2010. We measured the performance as well of the streets in between, because in Abu Dhabi it's a big theme, urban heat island. So downtown Abu Dhabi today on a sunny day is up to 60 degrees in the streets, because it's a copy of Manhattan, so you'd be proud. It's a copy of Manhattan, but in a totally wrong climate. So now our approach was to say we are building a very dense city, very narrow streets, self-shading, a lot of exposed mass, with our wind towers, getting the night wind, which is just 30 degrees into our streets to cool down the mass, to protect us against the 40 degree outside, and we could keep the ground of the street at 33. So we kept it 6 to 7 in the design, up to 10 degrees below the ambient temperature, which as well made the city more livable, because downtown Abu Dhabi on a sunny day is dead. Before like 7 o'clock in the evening, nobody goes out because it's too hot. They're crossing the street by taking a car from one side to the other. So energy-wise, we could the reference was around 400 kilowatt hours. The design was around 65. We reached in the first year around 100. And that was when I saw the last presentation on the energy numbers of the schools. I think all this needs, in a certain way as well, a performance support, because you will never in the first year reach the performance you're expecting in design. And I think that's as well the interesting, or the expectation. People say, I'm choosing a system and I think it performs. It will not. It will take, and you see in the next example, it will take several years of getting it down to the numbers. And I think the design is right. The only problem is that in a certain way, often what is built and what is designed doesn't fit together, and the built system then as well in performance doesn't meet the line often what was expected. So this is an example we did in Manitoba, an interesting starting point. Manitoba Hydro is the big energy supplier in Winnipeg. They have like 95% hydropower. They have a lot of lakes in the country, and they wanted to build a new headquarter. Now, politically, as a background, electricity in Canada is governmentally controlled, so the electricity price is governmentally limited, but the export to the US, not. So this means any kilowatt hour they save in Canada, they export as peak power to the US for 3 times the price. So this political situation made the energy suppliers in Canada the biggest supporters of any energy saving feature. You get your new lighting fixtures from them because they know you save electricity, they save 3 times more. So in a certain way, that's quite interesting how in a certain way a political decision and an economical boundary condition totally changed the performance. In our country, the energy suppliers they push you to consume electricity, because if you consume more, you get it cheaper than if you consume less. Even in Germany, it's still the case. So I think that totally changed their performance, and they decided their new headquarter downtown has to be the greenest tower in Canada. So, and you saw it's KPMG from Toronto, the architects, and Smith Carter as local architects from Winnipeg, kind of worked on this. AECOM was the engineering company doing structure and MEP with the energy concept. This is where Winnipeg is, and you can already see all that. That's all the water power. That's all the hydropower, which feeds into the grid. And then this is where they're exporting it to North Dakota. That's their customers for the high-price electricity. And it's a quite cold place. It gets down Celsius, minus 30. Which is quite cold, and you get wind chill factors, and it goes up to around 100, 110 Fahrenheit. So it's a quite cold spot. What is interesting, they decided they want to revitalize the urban center, to bring 2,000 workers from a suburb office, from a campus office, back into town. In a certain way, because this city was in a kind of dying out, they decided not to build only 18 parking down underground parking, because if someone comes with his car, he should go in public or in private parking lots around it. They didn't build a company canteen. They give vouchers, so everybody has to go out for lunch, which means 2,000 people go out for lunch from this center of the city, which means that's an alive center during a lot of time of the day. Here again, the team roughly did data around 700,000 square feet, 22,000 employees, around 280 million Canadian dollars. They were roughly in the range between 2 and 2.5% above their expected budget for this kind of low energy performance building. So the concept orienting, because it has a lot of sunny days. It's very cold in winter, but it has a lot. One of the most sunniest spots in Canada, around 1,500 kilowatt hours. So we oriented 3 6-floor high winter gardens facing south, getting the low winter sun for using it for preheating. A very compact building. There was a long discussion because they wanted to build the highest building in Winnipeg. That's a client. He wants to build the highest building. And we said, if we build a high building, the ratio between the surface, the useful surface, and the surrounding gets worse. We want to have a compact building in a certain way to make it protected against the hot and the cold outside. So finally, we built a solar chimney, which made it the highest building in town. So in a certain way, be creative to find solution to get a client what he wants. So, and it's kind of ventilated. The winter gardens are the preheating device. There's a heat recovery system, but then we can as well use the solar heating, preheating of the supply air, and it's pushed into the raised floors. There's no carpet on the outlets. We learned it. There's just a grill. And then the air is collected, and that's 90 meter long. There is no duct for the exhaust air. It's collected on a distance of 90 meters to the north side staircases, and then in winter it goes down to be heat recovered, and in summer it goes up out of the solar chimney. And in summertime, and individually, it's a double facade, both layers out of double glazing to make sure you don't get condensation. Or in the double facade, people can individually open their windows. And that's one of the, we saw the kind of the questionnaire of the users afterwards. One of the biggest response, positive response from these people, not being used to such a building where they can open a window, being in an office in Canada. Oops, I was too fast. So that's the daylighting approach, trying to lit all the spaces as much as possible with natural light, having more the meeting places along the inner wall, and then the big core with the elevators and the service rooms. We had a big fight with HOK, which did then finally the interior design to keep the cubicles, because they had cubicles which at the beginning were like more like 9 feet. And so they would cover all the daylight. So it was a big fight to keep the light coming in, feeding into the depths, in the depths of the office. We promised to reduce the energy from around the standard by code would be around this one by 60%. This is the building then built. Took some years. You see the solar chimney with some absorbers collecting the heat during the daytime, and as well allowing for a certain night ventilation. We have a big geothermal system as well. We did a detailed commissioning to get it to work, and I think that's as well important. Not only designing systems, you have to follow up even into operation to make sure it performs as expected. We looked on how many hours we can use natural ventilation. You see this is the hours. Around 35% of the year, the building is in natural ventilation mode. Even in the real operation, we measured much less energy for the fans than expected, even than expected. Now, the building has this, I don't know if this works. No, I think it doesn't work. It would be a picture of this moving, oops, oh my God. Okay, of this moving, okay, flaps, okay. And then we got the energy numbers. And after the first years, we were 100% above the target. So this was after 1 year measurement. The system was, even when we did the commissioning, the system was not working as expected. And you see, it took us nearly 3 years 2 years, after the third year of operation, we got it below the expected number. But it needed really a facility management and our kind of connection. We got all the data daily online to Germany to check the building, to perform the building, to get it into. All the systems were installed, but they were not kind of adjusted to each other. And I think that's the big problem, that clients expecting, they're buying a system, they may do a commissioning at the beginning and then they run it and nobody cares. Nobody cares if nobody looks on it. They're just wondering, oh my God, the operation costs are a bit higher than expected. Operation energy is more than we expected, but what can I do? So, and facility managers are not trained to do this. And then we looked on where are we spending it. This is one, retail distribution panels. We did get the fans down to 4%. Now the retail distribution, this is where you take your Coke. It take more than we had for the fan. This, my project leader, he was out of his mind. Said, this kind of little machines just cooling the Cokes, they take more electricity than we did for the whole building. So I think that's as well interesting. It gives you a comparison where you're spending. Where you're spending the energy. So, and we got a LEED Platinum for 3 year performance. So we measured the energy performance because the Canadian LEED system couldn't model our concept. So we did it by performance, and luckily Manitoba Hydro had enough political power to push the Canadian Green Building Council to accept a measured energy performance as a level to get the LEED certification and not the calculated one. Yeah, and this is how it has a very, these are the winter gardens where they now do the yoga courses, the yoga classes. It has a very positive resonance of the building, of the people. This is hard to see. Down here, that's the point. They are saving around $750,000 a year in operation cost. But the point is, this is not the big saving. The big saving is here. They typically get the 6 days off by 1.2 days per worker times 2,000. These are 2,500 work days. That's between 1 and 2 million a year savings. And I think that's as well interesting that this soft factors count more than the energy. So if we talk about energy, don't forget the people's energy. The people's energy is quite important because you pay for it. And if they are not there, they can't be productive. So hopefully they're often there being as productive as possible. So innovation, to have in mind, is coming, innovation which is coming. These are triple junction solar cells. They are using partially transparent cells. They take, each of them take a special spectrum out of the solar system. They go up to efficiency of 47%. The best systems today on the market is in a range of 20. So they are using, concentrating solar power, concentrating on this little, so that's the receiver concentrating it down to this little element where you get this high efficiency. So there is a move. We're talking about glass, and I talked to one of these manufacturers of a vacuum glass insulation. They developed in Colorado a system with a flexible joint, because that's the big problem in climates where it's very warm and very cold over the year, that you get this thermal stress in your vacuum insulation. And they did a flexible system to reach this. They are already down to R13. They're expecting, if they increase the vacuum, they could be down to R20. So this is something you do with two sheets of glass. Instead of have a triple glazing or a quadruple glazing where you reach this, this is as well material. They are using two layers of 4 millimeters of glass. That's it. Instead of having whatever, three layers, triple glazing is always as well a problem in buildings in respect of its dead weight of the glass. So, but at the moment, nobody's interested in this product because they talked to the customers of glass and they said, we want to replace the glass every 10 years. So why should we build something where, in a certain way, the performance is guaranteed over a period of 40 years? Interesting. Innovation. Now, this is a product, a proposal we developed with Stephen Hall. And here, for after Katrina, it's called floodgates for Manhattan. So the idea was to build three floodgates around the city, which in a certain way can be open. They are like linear buildings. They have like a passage where even ships can go through, that this middle part which can rotate, so that even the big Queen Mary II can still enter into Manhattan. And they have water turbines, and we got this lecture this morning about water turbines. They have these water turbines down here, tidal turbines, producing electricity. They have a big solar roof producing electricity. This is all a zero energy development for the city. Stephen Hall, I think that makes me proud, in his aquarelles, and you know he's designing aquarelles, he's already showing the hydropower elements in his aquarelles. Those, this is how, what Mark mentioned, that makes me proud, being influential of an architect of the first league, that he's thinking on geothermal system, on wind power, on hydropower, already in his design development. And we made a, and it would be 3.1 billion. So to build these three kind of floodgates, compared to the damage of Hurricane Sandy, 40, we hit this morning, even up to $60 billion, that's nothing. So I think that's quite what you have to think about to come up with new ideas. Now, concluding, I disagree with, Jeffrey Sachs, thank you. I disagree with Jeffrey Sachs that we have to set up a think tank to think about new technology. No. Most of the technologies we need to do this is today there. They may be not there in the performance we're expecting or we would like to have them, but it's there. I don't think, so we don't need another think tank on technology. We may think, need a think tank on how we communicate this problem, and I can only recommend to go to this presentation, to this talk tonight about communication of the climate change. And we need a think tank how we get leaders to take responsibility for the future by pushing for decisions today. And I think that's the big problem. Nobody wants to take the lead as well to do unpopular decisions. But I think the problems are so pushy that we have to do it. And I think 50%, and I think we saw it in a presentation before, 50% of the deal is our personal decision. So if we buy the best performing appliances today, we can already reduce our electricity bill by 50%. So it's not something to wait for. You can decide it on your next board, on your systems. So no future without decisions. And that's the last slide. I can only recommend to go there to listen to these people talking about how you communicate climate change in America. Thank you.
So I think we have just about 5 minutes.
Okay.
So I just have like a very quick question. Maybe should we go up and then maybe we take some questions from the audience. So, I mean, as if, as a final talk, it was too good actually to have a response. So,
oh,
really,
yeah. Come on,
really. But I give it a chance. So, of course, I love the first move that the issue is not about energy but about people. But since I come from, I mean, architects are not human beings, but they are similar. they look similar.
Visual animals.
Yeah. Just a little bit of a thought. So if it's about people, there are two directions, two questions in one. Can we think of a person as a little building? In other words, could it be the same question in the end? In other words, if really the question is about us, we can also think of ourselves, let's say, as a kind of micro structure, but also let's say the reverse. Like, is the very concept of a building a little bit a problem? In other words, it came up many, many times that even if I deal with the issues at the scale of the building, then the building is releasing. Then even the concept of externals is a thoroughly architectural concept. It's the concept that there is something outside the building. And of course, I think of kind of Bucky Fuller, who might say, well, better off that we were all be inside one building, like Manhattan should be inside one building. How you feel about this? Like, is the very idea of a building inefficient?
Okay, we need shelter. So, because our bodies cannot stand the outside condition. Okay, living in Africa at a certain level, or maybe in Bogota, if you have a coat in the morning, it's nice to stay. But in other climates, we cannot stay because it's getting too cold, too hot, too humid. So in a certain way, this is why we need a shelter. What is interesting, and you said the building is polluting the city. We as humans are polluting. We are polluting the spaces because we know if there are too many people in a small space, someone comes in and said, "Please open the window because the air is used." So I think that's something we have just to understand. But I think what we can draw as a parallel is I think we should understand buildings and city as organisms which are breathing. And in a certain way, they create waste. For sure, we create waste too. So in a certain way, we have to find a way that in a community you can handle it. And I think that's as well the interesting way I think the Swiss approach with the society in mind and not the individual in mind is such a great thing. And they decided for a society and the individuals in the majority voted for it. Unbelievable how a country can be already so far. So I wouldn't expect the Germans would vote for it. If they could, our system doesn't allow it. So therefore, I think this is something we have to understand, that such an approach we can only solve in a society. And there might be even in buildings, in architecture, there might be buildings in New York you better don't touch. But there might be a neighborhood building who produces enough energy to feed them both. So that's how a community can work. And we heard from Anna Dyson as well, the input, one produces an overproduction and the other can use it, and the next day it's the other way around. So I think that's dynamic systems where, in a certain way, I think we should use, we should better understand. Until now, it's typically an individual approach. Everybody does.
Because I know, I think it didn't come up even once today, which is strange because I think everything came up today. Which is why I enjoyed it. That was not much reflection, maybe not even once, on this stored or embedded or implied energy in an existing building. In other words, the level of investment that we have already stored, we've decided to store energy in this form that we call a city, and that capacity was never referred to. So it's as if whatever the future of energy is, it will be something new that we do rather than the way we react to something that we already have.
Yeah, and it's roughly 50% in a building is kind of the main structure and the foundation in respect of embedded energy. So like the Deutsche Bank, who refurbished their two towers downtown in Frankfurt, they kept the main structure, they kept the foundation because this was 50% of the gray embedded energy, and they said this would be such a strong, in a certain way, account. We would need to, in a certain way, to save for 30 years the energy in operating it 30% below the code to be a balance in what we spend in replacing the existing foundation and structure.
Right, so the historic preservation, the field of historic preservation becomes then maybe a potential key collaborator and ally with engineers because they are able to identify that stored energy that should be not transformed. It should be kept in its current form.
And some of the buildings are just the expectations to the buildings, like we did the refurbishment of IIT Crown Hall. Mies designed it for not to be used in summer because there was vacation. There was no summer school. Now they're using summer school and everybody complains that it's too hot. But they cut out all the trees around the building, which were the main shading of the building. So in a certain way, that's as well a point of looking to old buildings, and we just did it as well for the Bauhaus in Dessau. Kind of, you have to kind of recover what there were basic approaches. Some of them didn't think that so much glazing does not good, but in a certain way, often they considered some aspects which we have to find out, which were digged down or forgotten by just installing another AC system.
So staying with this a little bit, if let's say the architect and an engineer could be collaborating on changing the way we see things, in other words, the question is how we design not so much the building but the way we think, and that would be our primary responsibility. Instead of having a toolbox and we solve a problem, we would actually try to design a slightly different brain. How do you feel about, and as came up many times today, the actual performance of the very best buildings following the best principles. The performance is either doesn't measure exactly the way you wish, or it's not clear which way you should measure it, or we are all measuring it differently. But at some level, the success is not visible. So if you take architecture, which has been for so long a field of kind of visible, that I will change your mind by something you can see. Yeah. Now we have a problem to change people's mind with something that you can't see. So I'm wondering how you feel, for example, about these attitudes towards designing systems by which you actually know the performance of the building just simply by stupid things like numbers, screens, dials, yeah, and so on. Because yeah, I never see it in your work. So in your work, for example, the sauna building, it's almost the beauty of it is you don't see anything. That's what they love. They love that you see nothing.
Yeah. Exactly.
And is that a problem in terms of this mission, let's say, of changing people's perception?
I think people shouldn't be in a certain way. I think a good building should just perform so good, and Manitoba Hydro is a perfect example. The resonance of the people is not about the resonance of the number. They don't care about the number. In a certain way, the employees, they care about the quality of the indoor spaces. And this is the big resonance on the building. And this is why we typically as well, our approach is putting people first and getting good working, good living environments. And then it's our task to do it with the lowest numbers possible. But if they don't see anything, that's the perfect way of doing it.
So for you, instead of having a meter with some numbers that spin around, and we know that for some people numbers are very, very sexy and can make them very happy, but for you, it would be the smile on the face of the person using the building that would be the main political device.
Yes.
Okay, but it seems like a good... I mean, because the lecture begins exactly with this... Your question was, are we happy with all of this? And so then the responsibility of some kind of collaboration of architect, engineer, politician, website designer, historic preservationist is to concentrate on the faces of the people who are...
Yeah, concentrate on the faces and having in mind that we want as well the next generation to have the chance to have this smile on the face. So that's why... We may need to do decisions, because if you tell people that they have to reduce their apartment from 150 to 75 square meters, their smile might be frozen for some days, yeah, some weeks. So but that's something, I think that's what I see, what we have to do. Some of these decisions had to be done, because otherwise there will be situations where nobody will ask if it will change your smile, they will just decide it. And I think one provocative, we had it during the lunch break and I didn't include it because I forgot it, would be one example, one point Matthias shows, this is a non-democratic system, a non-elective. I always was talking about so it's a non-elective system, I learned from a British engineer to describe it. But this non-elective system could do the decision, whatever, in 2 weeks that this city could connect to the public grid and feed electricity in, which was not possible by law 2 weeks before. So the question is, and that's something we have to rethink as a provocation, are our democratic systems fast enough to respond on the challenge of climate change?
Yeah. I mean, maybe not, because one... Even if they were better, because one possible theory is that telling everybody that we're going to die and soon doesn't seem to change people's behavior. And as Freud would tell us anyway, our relationship to the question of death is quite complicated. So people who smoke a lot, it's quite hard to tell them to stop smoking because they might die. Actually, it makes them want to have another cigarette. So in the same way, it seems that since, let's say, the Club of Rome, it has been very clear where we are going. And now maybe we are going faster, and we can even explain to people even more clearly how terrible it is. And all of the metrics continue to rise. So we are basically dying faster, bigger, right? So when I was thinking of this thing that I don't know if you saw the film about the revolution in Chile, which was where they had the opportunity to protest the government, the fascist government of that time. And they had a choice between making a more classical socialist argument, like, you have been a terrible person, we are really unhappy, and so on, and we need to get rid of you. And the reason they won the campaign is that they did the opposite. They made a campaign that says, happiness is coming. So basically the message was, everything is about to be much, much better. And of course they won. I mean, to his amazement, he was thrown out of the government. So it seems to me one possibility is, and where I think, you know, Juan's point about the architect might come in. If you think of Sachs's idea about backcasting, and instead of projecting an image of imminent Armageddon, you present the image of this better place that's been enabled by new design, new technologies, and new policies, and new regulations, and you show a very, very happy image, and then reverse engineer. I think this is a very, very different mindset than even the one that Jeffrey Sachs implied. In other words, instead of saying, we have a disaster, so we have to solve the problem and then make sure we don't get into the problem, if you say, on the other hand, there is something very beautiful about to happen soon as we are going to develop these amazing things and then reverse engineer. And that, for me, is a little bit of a reason why even if the human is not a very, the architect is not a very human species, the architect might be quite useful, because the architect has only one special skill, it seems to be, to basically accept an impossible commission. Every architectural commission is impossible. If it was possible, you would ask an engineer. You ask an architect, because it doesn't seem that all that information can be combined. Right, so I think the architect is sort of a splendid figure to say, look, given that we're all going to die very fast, and we've been working very hard on this. I mean, we have been even every day invented new ways to die more quickly, and to give our grandchildren a kind of smoldering ruin of a planet. That's a great moment to say to the architect, okay, it's impossible, possible situation, so please, can we work with you and make an image of a city or a life or a society or a policy, and then we can work backwards from there.
Yeah, and I think life quality, in my opinion, life quality in a city, in a building, is determined by the architecture. And the life standard, maybe by the square meters, but I think we should focus more on the quality than on the standard.
So we could end this meeting today on a kind of a happy note. Which would sort of say that the single best idea we have in the face of this is the idea of the city. That is to say, the idea of cosmopolitan density, which by definition implies a sharing of resources, a capacity to pass energy through a whole series of transformations relatively effectively, and that this city then is, you know, maybe in the end is the only path, because that's what an architect would say. You see, so you're being tricked here.
I agree.
But maybe we can grab a quick question. Yes, from outer space.
I'm Jonathan.
Jonathan, sorry.
The question I have is, if you look at the architecture from 40 or 50 years ago, and you think about what the architecture would be like 40 or 50 years from now, the most important thing in a biological system is that it dies, and it leaves space for evolving and improving and getting.
So, did you hear me? Should I say that again? Okay. So the real the underlying question is, what's the lifespan of these buildings? And is it pretentious on the architect's part to think that these buildings should last forever or even be or rather they should be built with the idea that they need to evolve and that they should be built to die, in the sense that they should be built so that they leave behind some residue, their DNA or their imprint or their important message to the next generation of buildings, building on the idea that it's a living system of some kind. They leave behind their adaptive qualities, but a lot of the rest of the building is acknowledged early on that it's obsolete, that it will be obsolete. It's not obsolete when we build it, but it's clearly going to be obsolete, maybe in 5 years, maybe in 10, maybe in 20. But it will clearly be obsolete. And I don't hear this discussion when we're talking about buildings. They're sort of, we put up buildings and we sort of expect them to be monuments of our time and go on for ad infinitum or whatever. But are you talking or thinking about building buildings that are meant to die, that are meant to go away, that are meant to be refurbished completely?
Yeah. I think there's a difference in private buildings. You think more on a longer lifespan. So building housing in Europe, normally you build, you die there, your children hopefully will live there, and maybe you aren't children as well. So you build houses typically for 3 generations or more. If you do it more in industrial buildings, I think there the idea certainly of a different use is embedded in a certain flexibility you're trying to embed in it. And I think loft buildings, industrial loft buildings, are the best examples. They were designed to be industrial buildings, but nowadays they are often used for residential uses or for offices. And I think New York is a great example for this. So I think, and in this case, mainly it's the structure. The facade may change, but the structure typically stays there. And I think that's something we should have in mind. And maybe that's the remaining, you say, if it, whatever, it's the skeleton of the building which stays there. And then you can, whatever, cut pieces out, do 2 floors together, and introduce new elements, new kind of apartments into it.
We have time for one last question from Craig.
Matthias, I big admirer of your work. I think really fantastic presentation. Question that we were talking about earlier about carbon and this basic issue about regulating carbon. Which would ultimately change, you know, energy pricing in certain areas. Now, you work everywhere in the world. You obviously work in areas that carbon is more highly regulated and where it's less highly regulated. Can you give an indication of if it's easier to work in one or other of those environments?
I think typically working with our clients, I'm not using the carbon argument, or we often not using the carbon argument as a support for a certain direction. I think it's often, and that's a certain strategy, together with the architects to get the client excited on a certain approach, in a certain way to make him a member of this approach, not to save the world, but to make this world a better place. Instead of going in the deep, deep numbers of carbon balancing and even economical balancing, I think all our underground preconditioning concepts we built, and around 30 of them, none of them were economical feasible. But we got all of the clients excited. And when they moved in the building, they felt they did something special. And I think that's, in a certain way, how we are, in this case, what I said, getting these decision makers, in a certain way, excited. And it's, if it's a private client or even a company CEO who builds for his own company, it's much easier than you have someone who is running a kind of real estate firm, because he has no personal connection to it. So that's why, luckily, most of our clients are building their own museum buildings, offices, whatever. So I'm sure in the typical spec world, the battle would be much harder. And okay, we are not so big, so luckily we can choose the nice. But the idea is still to say there should be a certain thinking behind it, which hopefully multiplies, because that's, we will not change the world. We need another 1,000 of this kind of movers to get a change.
Meanwhile, this is one of the coldest rooms in New York, and it's amazing to me that we didn't manage to warm up the room. There's only one other room I know of that has this degree of cold on a day as hot as this, and it's up at the School of Architecture at Columbia, so I'm feeling very much at home. Just to touch the point you raised, there's nothing necessarily or obviously different between a plant and a building. There's no sort of easy distinction. You can't necessarily say one's made by humans and one's made by, anyway, who do you think made the plants and so on. There are not these very strict differences, and it can be argued that architecture is a form of agriculture and has been argued many, many times. And if you take a city like New York, what you described as a more sort of complex philosophy of buildings aging, dying, and so on, is actually pretty much what goes on in a city like Manhattan, and shedding and so on. The more natural you would think of New York, the more you would think of it as in biological terms and organic terms, the more you then would be sensitive to what's being shed, as you would be of your own body, what's being shed, what's been kept, what's breathing, what's not breathing. So I think part of what has held back more sophisticated thinking about the performance of architecture is to assume that because man-made, it's already somehow wrong, like inadequate, too simple. The most human thing about the human species is technology, right? And architecture in that sense is thoroughly human and in every possible sense. So I think if you hesitate in front of that word energy, I do think if you hesitate for a moment, you can return to something like architecture, society, regulation, and so on, with a different philosophy in mind. To just give you the most obvious example, any reference to the regulation of temperature, just the idea that, or the idea that regulation of a society is actually always thought of in kind of environmental control terms. Like if you listen to people who speak about what the law is, what is law, what is regulation, what is society, actually what they refer to are the kind of weather conditions within which, environmental conditions. So it's not a matter of saying, let's develop environmental legislation, et cetera. No, legislation is already environmental. And actually, much of what we are worried about is the result of specific environmental legislation that does not have these negative effects as unexpected consequences, but were in a certain sense designed. So I think to the extent that we think of the existing situation as much more organic, much more to do with a very complex understanding of energy, actually it's a question of us catching up to the complexity that we're describing. And that's what I found in the presentations throughout the whole day was so beautiful, the layering that was coming through. If you combine all these voices, I'm just saying only that as long as it's kind of an us or them, this is not going to really work. So for example, it's not going to work for us to sit in a room in which such an enormous amount of energy is being deployed so that we could feel cold on a hot day and discuss energy issue. But I hope it's really, really obvious why it is that Matthias was just exactly the right person to end the beginning of this project.